Ambassador Taylor, Mr. Kent, President Trump's concerns about Ukraine's role in the 2016 election, you believe he genuinely believed they were working against him, right? Ambassador Taylor?
Ms. Castor, I don't know what President or candidate Trump was thinking about the Ukrainians.
I mean, didn't he in this Oval Office meeting on May 23rd after the Zelensky inauguration, didn't he lament that the Ukrainians were out to get him?
I heard that his response to the suggestion that Mr. Zelensky visit Mr. Trump, President Trump, in the Oval Office was not well received, and that he had concerns about Ukrainians, yes.
But from the president's perspective, if the ambassador, Ukrainian ambassador to the United States, one of the most influential diplomats, is penning an op-ed, certainly with the okay of President Poroshenko, the DNC consultants are conferring with Ukrainian officials at the embassy. Former Prime Minister Yatseniak is saying things on social media. Interior Minister Avakov, who has spanned both the Poroshenko and the Zelensky realm, is also saying some very unkind things on social media about the president. You certainly can appreciate that President Trump was very concerned that some elements of the Ukrainian establishment were not in favor of him, did not support him, and were out to get him.
If I go to, and I'll allow the question, but are you
are
asking?
You really, are you parliamentary inquiry? Are you seriously interrupting our time here?
I will allow the question. I won't dock this from the time. I just want to be clear, Ambassador. If you're able to verify the things that counsel has asked you in the prerequisite of the question, that's fine. Otherwise, in questions from the majority or the minority that may assume facts not in evidence before you, you should be cautioned about that.
Mr. Chairman, point of order.
The time is with with minority counsel.
Mr. Ratcliffe.
Chairman, I sat here through the first 45 minutes and literally had an objection to almost the foundation of every question that Mr. Goldman asked regarding facts not in evidence, leading. But House Resolution 660 does not say that we are under the federal rules of evidence. If it is your position that I should be asserting objections to questions that violate the federal rules of evidence, let me know now, because this hearing is going to change significantly.
As I said, Mr. Ratcliffe, I will allow the question.
I think the gentleman has a different question about the rules. So what are the rules that are going to govern this?
Does the ranking member seek recognition?
I'm yielding you to a question I just asked you.
For what purpose do you seek recognition?
To answer Mr. Ratcliffe's question.
I have answered it. You may resume your question.
Respectfully, Mr. Chairman. You haven't answered my question whether or not I should be asserting assumes facts not in evidence or leading objections to questions that are posed from this point forward. That's my question.
Mr. Ratcliffe, I'll say once again, I'm not objecting to the question, but I am instructing the witness that they should not presume questions from the majority or the minority that may represent facts not in evidence are correct. I have answered the question. We will resume the questioning and resume the clock.
Mr. Castor. So you certainly can appreciate President Trump's concerns.
Ms. Castor, I don't know the exact nature of President Trump's concerns. In my deposition, I recall you handed me the Politico article which listed at least three of the elements that you have described earlier. And you've recognized, and I have confirmed with the ranking minority member, that first I'd heard of those and was surprised by those. I don't know President Trump's reaction to those.
In the information published by Sergei Leshenko, former Ukrainian investigative journalist, and then he was a member of the parliament, about the Manafort black ledgers, in August of 2016, I mean, the very day that was published, Mr. Manafort resigned from the campaign, correct?
I don't know, Mr. Castor.
But certainly that gives rise to some concern that there are elements of the Ukrainian establishment that were out to get the president. That's a very reasonable belief of his, correct?
I don't know.
The run-up to the 2016 election, there's many facts that remain unresolved. Agreed?
I'm sorry, what's the question?
There are many facts relating to the run-up of the 2016 election that remain unresolved.
Any further?
Well, Attorney General Barr, in May of 2019, tasked the U.S. Attorney for Connecticut, John Durham, to broadly examine the government's collection of intelligence involving the president's campaign. That effort, initially was an administrative review, has turned into a criminal probe. And U.S. Attorney Durham is casting a wide net and is following the facts where they may lead. Are you aware of that?
I'm aware that there is an investigation. That's as much as I'm aware.
And so to the extent any information resides in Ukraine, it's perfectly appropriate for the Ukrainians to try to get to the bottom of that, for the Ukrainians to cooperate with the United States through official channels to share that information, correct?
Ms. Castor, can you say that one again? I'd appreciate it if you would restate the question.
To the extent Ukraine has facts related to the run-up of the 2016 election that are under the U.S. Attorney Durham's probe, Ukraine should cooperate with the United States, and to the extent there are Ukrainians doing improper things, the Ukrainians ought to investigate that themselves, correct?
Ms. Castor, the Ukrainian-American relations are very supportive. The Ukrainians will certainly be responsive to requests.
So when the president on the call transcript of July 25th raises this with President Zelensky, and he urges that there be a connection between the Ukrainian government and the Justice Department officially, I mean, that's the appropriate way to raise an issue with the Ukrainian president, correct?
It's appropriate for the Justice Department and the Prosecutor General to cooperate and to exchange information, yes.
But to the extent the president has concerns and to the extent the Attorney General is having the U.S. Attorney Durham look into that, isn't it entirely appropriate for the president to flag this for President Zelensky and say that you should be in touch with our official channels?
Ms. Castor, I don't know the precise appropriateness of these kinds of relations.
Now, were you involved, either of you, involved with the preparation for the 725 call?
I was not.
I was not.
And how do you account for that? I mean, you are the two of the key officials with responsibility for Ukrainian policy. I mean, if the President of the United States is going to have a call with the leader of Ukraine, why wouldn't you ordinarily be involved with the preparation?
Sir, we work for the Department of State in an embassy overseas, and in preparation for a presidential phone call, that responsibility lies with the staff of the National Security Council. Normally, if there is enough sufficient time, National Security staff can solicit information, usually from the State Department, and we can draw on the embassy. But that's only background information, and my understanding, having never worked at the National Security Council, is that National Security staff write a memo to the president, and none of us see that outside of the National Security staff.
Okay, so the chargé or the U.S. ambassador to the country wouldn't ordinarily be on a call with a foreign leader?
That's correct. Would not.
And did Colonel Vindman or anyone at the National Security Council staff reach out to you, Mr. Kent, in preparation for the call?
I was given notification the day before on July 24th, and to the extent I had any role, it was to reach out to the embassy, give them the heads up, and ask them to ensure that the secure communications link in the Office of the President of Ukraine was functional so the call could be patched through from the White House Situation Room.
Did you provide any substantive advice to Colonel Vindman about the call and what ought to be the official position?
I was not asked, and I did not provide.
Okay. Same with you, Ambassador?
The same.
And the call was scheduled, you know, you testified earlier that the call was on again, off again. And after the July 10th meeting with Ambassador Bolton, the consensus was the call was not going to happen. Is that correct?
I would not say that was a consensus. The State Department's position was that a call between the two presidents would be useful. Mm-hmm. And once Zelensky's party won the first ever absolute majority in parliamentary elections on July 21st, the idea of a congratulatory call made eminent sense from our perspective.
Okay, and the call was scheduled. And did you get a readout, Ambassador Taylor, initially from the call?
I didn't, Mr. Castor. We all read the statement that the Ukrainians put out. I got a readout several days later from Mr. Morrison, National Security Council.
Okay. And how about you, Mr. Kent?
I likewise first saw the Ukrainian statement, and I believe the next day, July 26th, which would have been a Friday, I did get a partial readout from Lieutenant Colonel Vindman, yes.
Ambassador Taylor, you said that the Ukrainian readout was cryptic. Is that just because it's initially written in Ukrainian and translated to the U.S.?
No, it's, as a general rule, both United States and other countries, including Ukraine, will put out very short summaries that kind of hit the highlights of the discussion, but without going into detail.
Okay. And you mentioned it was cryptic. Why did you think it was cryptic?
Knowing now what, having read the transcript and looking back at their summary, mm-hmm. As I recall, and I don't recall the exact words, but they said that there were issues to be pursued in order to improve relations between the two countries or something like that.
That seems pretty ordinary.
It seems pretty ordinary.
You were with President Zelensky the very next day?
We were. We had a meeting with him the very next day.
And did President Zelensky raise any concerns about his views of the call?
He said, I, Ambassador Volker, Ambassador Sondland were in his office, and we asked him, I think, how the call. He said, call was fine. I was happy with the call.
Okay. And did you get any additional readouts subsequently about the call? Like, when did you first learn that the call contained things that concerned you? Was that not until September 25th?
Morrison, as I say, briefed me several days later, before the end of July, and he, I think this is where I said in my testimony that he said it could have gone better, mm-hmm. And he said it mentioned that the call mentioned Mr. Giuliani. Mm-hmm. He also said that the call mentioned the former ambassador. Both of those were concerning.
Giuliani was first raised on the call by President Zelensky, correct?
I don't recall.
Okay.
It could have been. Well, I have it here if you'd like.
Yeah, it's on page.
Very good.
Page 3. The first mention of Giuliani is from President Zelensky, and it's on page 3. And President Zelensky says, "I will personally tell you that one of my assistants spoke with Mr. Giuliani just recently, and we are hoping very much that Mr. Giuliani will be able to travel to Ukraine, and we will meet once he comes to Ukraine." Did that surprise you?
Again, I didn't have the transcript at the time. All I heard was that that Giuliani was mentioned. Mr. Morrison said that Giuliani was mentioned in the call.
But the way Zelensky states it here, it sounds like he is very much looking forward to speaking with America's mayor.
That's what I found out when I read the transcript on the 25th of September or so.
Okay. Now, Mr. Kent, corruption in Ukraine is endemic, correct?
That's correct.
And it affects the courts, the prosecutors, and there have historically been problems with all the prosecutors in Ukraine, correct?
I would say up until the new set of prosecutors appointed by President Zelensky in the last 2 months, correct.
Okay, and so the U.S. government, the consensus hope at the State Department and the National Security Council and the White House is that Zelensky's the real deal. He's a real reformer. He's genuinely interested in rooting out corruption, prosecuting the bad guys, correct?
I would say we are cautiously optimistic, and we will work wherever there is the political will to do the right thing and put forward genuine reform.
And at the heart of the corruption is this oligarchical system, correct? Where the oligarchs take control, often by a virtual theft of, you know, for example, the right to certain energy licenses, correct?
That is one element, yes, sir.
And the company Burisma, its leader Sochevsky, he has a little bit of a storied history of corruption, doesn't he?
Mr. Zlochevsky was Minister of Energy from 2010 to 2012 under the pro-Russian government, and he used his regulatory authority to award gas exploration licenses to companies that he himself controlled. That would be considered an act of corruption in my view, yes.
And certainly self-dealing.
Certainly self-dealing and self-enriching.
And how did the Ukrainian government ultimately pursue that?
In the spring of 2014, the Ukrainian government, the new government after the Revolution of Dignity, turned to partners, particularly the US and the UK, to try to recover tens of billions of dollars of stolen assets. The first case that we tried to recover that money came from Mr. Zlochevsky. Serious Crimes Office in the UK had already opened up an investigation. They worked with us and the Ukrainian authorities to develop more information. The $23 million was frozen until somebody in the General Prosecutor's Office of Ukraine shut the case, issued a letter to his lawyer, and that money went poof.
So essentially paid a bribe to make the case go away?
That is our strong assumption, yes, sir.
Okay. Now, at any point in time, has anyone in the Ukrainian government tried to reinvestigate that, or did those crimes just go unpunished, and was he free to go?
Mr. Zlochevsky spent time, as far as I understand, in Moscow and Monaco after he fled Ukraine. We continued to raise as a point of order that because U.S. taxpayer dollars had been used to try to recover frozen assets, that we have a fiduciary responsibility, and we continued to press Ukrainian officials to answer for why alleged corrupt prosecutors had closed a case, and we have, till now, not gotten a satisfactory answer. So, to summarize, we thought that Mokola's Zlochevsky had stolen money. We thought a prosecutor had taken a bribe to shut the case, and those were our main concerns.
And are you in favor of that matter being fully investigated and prosecuted?
I think since U.S. taxpayer dollars were wasted, I would love to see the Ukrainian Prosecutor General's office find who the corrupt prosecutor was that took the bribe and how much it was paid. And that's what I said to the Deputy Prosecutor General on February 3rd, 2015.
But in addition to prosecuting the person that took the bribes, shouldn't the organization or individual that sponsored the bribes be prosecuted?
I would agree that the Ukrainian law authorities should uphold the rule of law and hold people account for breaking Ukrainian law.
So this company, Burisma, involved in lots of criminal activity, correct?
I do not know that.
But over the years, it's been involved in a number of questionable dealings, correct?
I would say that it's the largest private gas producer in the country, and its business reputation is mixed.
So to the extent a new regime is coming in under President Zelensky, it certainly would be fair for the new prosecutor, a genuine prosecutor, to reexamine old crimes that hadn't sufficiently been brought to justice, right?
I believe that the new Prosecutor General, Ruslan Rybyshapka, made a statement to that end that they would be reviewing past cases. Mm-hmm. But keep in mind, this is a country where those that commit crimes generally never get held to account, so there's a lot to review.
Okay. Now, this the bribe was paid in what year?
To the best of my knowledge, the case against Zlochevsky, the former minister, was shut down December of 2014.
Okay. And right around that time, Burisma starts adding officials to its board, is that correct?
Understanding is yes, that Zlochevsky invited a series of new individuals to join the board in 2014.
And do you know what his strategy was in adding officials to his board?
I have never met Mr. Zlochevsky.
Okay, and who are some of the folks he added to the board?
The most prominent person he added to the board was the former president of Poland, Aleksander Kwasniewski.
And anyone else?
There were a number of others, including some Americans, and the most prominent one in this context is Hunter Biden.
Okay, so Hunter Biden's added to the board of Burisma. Now, do you think that creates a problem that Burisma may be adding people to its board for protection purposes?
Sir, I work for the government. I don't work in the corporate sector, and so I believe that companies build their boards with a variety of reasons, not only to promote their business plans.
Was Hunter Biden a corporate governance expert?
I have no idea what Hunter Biden studied at university or what his CV says.
Mike, is he the Jeffrey Sonnenfeld of the Ukraine?
I have no awareness or knowledge of what his background was and what he may have done on the border.
Okay, so you don't know whether he has any business experience in Ukraine prior to joining Burisma's board?
I've heard nothing about prior experience.
Okay,
no.
Do you know if he speaks Ukrainian?
I do not.
Do you know if he possesses any other element other than the fact that he is the son of, at the time, the sitting vice president?
I do not.
Okay. Ambassador Taylor, do you know whether Hunter Biden offers anything other than the fact that his dad's the former vice president?
I don't.
Or at the time was the vice president?
I have no knowledge of Hunter Biden.
But you would agree it raises questions, right? He was getting paid, I think, $50,000 a month to sit on the board. Did you know if he relocated to Ukraine?
I'm sorry, Mr. Castor, say again.
Do you know if Hunter Biden relocated to Ukraine?
No knowledge.
Do you know, Mr. Kent?
Again, no knowledge.
Okay. So he's getting paid $50,000 a month, but we don't know whether he had any experience, he had any, he spoke the language, or whether he moved to Ukraine, correct?
Correct.
Now, at this time, Vice President Biden was taking a specific interest in Ukraine, wasn't he?
He was.
And could you tell us about that?
I believe while he was vice president, he made a total of 6 visits to Ukraine. One may have been during the old regime, Yanukovych, and that would make 5 visits after the Revolution of Dignity, which started February of 2014.
Okay, and you were the DCM, the Deputy Chief of Mission at the time, correct?
Starting in 2015, yes.
Okay, and did Vice President Biden come when you were at post?
He did not. I came back for Ukrainian language training, and so I missed several visits.
Now, you've seen Vice President Biden's, he's sort of given a speech, and he's a little folksy about how he went into Ukraine and he told the Ukrainians that if they don't fire the prosecutor, they're going to lose their $1 billion in loan guarantees. You've seen that, correct?
I have. I think it was a speech at the Council of Foreign Relations in January 2018.
Right. And he also said that he's been there, to Ukraine 13 times. Do you know if that's accurate?
To the best of my knowledge, when he was vice president, he made 6 visits.
And did the State Department ever express any concerns to the vice president's office that the vice president's role at the time in engaging on Ukraine presented any issues?
No, the vice president's role was critically important. It was top cover to help us pursue our policy agenda.
Okay, but given Hunter Biden's role in Burisma's board of directors, at some point you testified in your deposition that you expressed some concern to the vice president's office. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And what did they do about that concern that you expressed?
I have no idea. I reported my concern to the office of the vice president.
Okay, and that was the end of it? Nobody?
You would have to ask people who worked in the office of the vice president during 2015.
But after you expressed the concern of a perceived conflict of interest at the least, the vice president's engagement in Ukraine didn't decrease, did it?
Correct, because the vice president was promoting U.S. policy objectives in Ukraine.
And Hunter Biden's role on the board of Burisma didn't cease, did it?
To the best of my knowledge, it didn't. And my concern was that there was the possibility of a perception of a conflict of interest.
Now, Ambassador Taylor, I want to turn to the discussion of the irregular channel you describe. In fairness, this irregular channel of diplomacy, it's not as outlandish as it could be. Is that correct?
It's not as outlandish as it could be. Yeah, I agree, Mr. Castor.
Okay, we have Ambassador Volker, who's a former Senate-confirmed ambassador to NATO, a longtime State Department diplomat, and you've known Ambassador Volker for years, correct?
That's correct.
A man of unquestioned integrity, correct?
That's correct.
And somebody with incredible knowledge of the region.
With very good knowledge of the region.
Yes, and sir. The best interests of the United States?
Yeah, I'm sure that's right.
And the best interests of Ukraine?
His first priority is clearly the United States.
Okay.
And to the extent that Ukraine has an implication for that, yes.
Okay.
Ukraine as well.
And the second member of the irregular channel is Ambassador Sondland, who is Senate confirmed, ambassador to the EU. So his involvement here, while not necessarily part of his official duties as the ambassador to the EU, it certainly is not outlandish for him to be interested and engaged pursuant to the President or Secretary Pompeo's direction, correct?
It's a little unusual for the U.S. ambassador to the EU to play a role in Ukraine policy.
Okay. And, you know, it might be irregular, but it's certainly not outlandish. And then Secretary Perry is the third member of the irregular channel, certainly a Senate-confirmed official, somebody with deep experience in energy markets, and he was pursuing some liquefied natural gas projects in Ukraine?
That's correct, Mr. Castor.
So his involvement, Secretary Perry's involvement, is perfectly acceptable?
It is.
Okay. Now, this irregular channel as it developed, when did you determine that it became problematic? I mean, you in your opening statement identified yourself appropriately as the leader of the regular channel.
At least a participant. Here's another leader of the regular channel.
So when did you first develop concerns that the irregular channel was being problematic?
So I arrived in Kyiv in mid-September. By late September, a couple of phone calls with...
You arrived in Kyiv in June, right?
June
17th?
Mid-June.
Yep.
June 17th, thank you. And so by the end of June, I had begun to hear references to investigations. Mm-hmm. As something that would have to happen prior to the meeting that President Trump had offered to President Zelensky.
Okay.
And that began to raise questions for me.
Okay. Now you've known Ambassador Volker, and you've certainly have a reason to know Ambassador Sondland. What did you do at this point, or did you ever try to wrest control of the irregular channel?
I didn't try to wrest control of the irregular channel do that. At the time when I
Why not though? If you have these concerns.
Because Ms. Castor, at the time as Ambassador Kent, no, Deputy Assistant Secretary Kent testified, both channels were interested in having a meeting between President Zelensky and President Trump. So there's no reason to kind of wrest control if we're going in the same direction.
But at some point, you developed concerns. I mean, your opening statement is here. I mean, you're the impeachment witness number one, and you're number two, Mr. Kent. You know, for the case impeaching the President of the United States, because of the concerns you've testified about the irregular channel, correct?
I was concerned when the irregular channel appeared to be going against the irregular channel was going against the overall direction of and purpose of the regular channel.
So, and as I understand the record, however, you when you arrived in Ukraine, you had the support of the secretary and the secretary's top advisor, counselor Ulrich Breckbuhl, correct?
That is correct.
And they assured you that if you had any concerns, you would be able to contact them, and they would have your back.
That is correct.
And you knew going in that the Rudy Giuliani element presented some complexities, correct?
I was concerned about Rudy Giuliani's statements and involvement in the Ukraine policy, yes.
Okay. So when it genuinely became, a concern for you, what did you do to either engage Sondland and Volker and Perry, Giuliani. By the way, have you ever met Rudy Giuliani during these times relevant?
Not during the times relevant. Mr. Giuliani visited Ukraine one time when I was there, I think in 2007 or 8.
Okay.
That's the only time I've met him.
Okay. So you've never had any communications with Rudy Giuliani as part of these irregular channel business matters?
That's correct. That's correct.
Okay. And anyway, getting back to my question, did you try to engage Breck Buell or the secretary during this time period? I know you said that you had, I believe, an August 21st or 22nd telephone call with Breck Buell. You had a July 10th telephone call with Breck Buell, and then you sent a first-person cable to the secretary on August 29th?
That's correct.
Is that sort of the universe of initiatives you took inside the State Department to raise your concerns about the irregular channel?
I also raised my concerns with Deputy Assistant Secretary George Kent. In particular, early on when I think I may have mentioned this phone call that was odd in that it did not include the normal staff, mm-hmm. Indeed, Ambassador Sondland's staff, and that struck me as unusual. I consulted with Mr. Kent, and at his suggestion, made a note of this, and also had, I think at that point, I had a conversation with Mr. Breck Buell.
That was a June 28th call, I believe?
That's correct.
And in your opening statement, you expressed some concerns about what Ambassador Sondland had said, but then once Zelensky got on the phone, it proceeded in a very regular channel way, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So the June 28th call, at least in and of itself, didn't ultimately, as it played out, present any problems for you?
The call with President Zelensky did not. The preparation for that call, the preparation included maybe 15 minutes of just the Americans mm-hmm. that would stay on the call.
Right.
And that, again, that was a little irregular in that it didn't have the staff. Mm-hmm. It was also in that pre-call, in that mm-hmm. 15 minutes before President Zelensky got on the phone, where Ambassador Volker told the rest of the participants that he was planning to have a conversation with President Zelensky in Toronto in 3 days, mm-hmm. 4 days, where he would outline for President Zelensky the important mm-hmm. components of the phone call that we were trying to establish.
Okay. And you didn't have any issue with that, did you?
The only issue I had with that, Mr. Castor, was there was reference to investigations in, I believe that's, I'll have to check my notes okay. on that, but that, it raised issues for me that I didn't understand what Ambassador Volker had in mind that he was specifically going to raise okay. with Mr. Zelensky. That was a little bit of a concern.
Okay. I mean, the president's expressed his, interest in certain investigations, certainly relating to the 2016 election and relating to this corrupt Burisma outfit. So that wasn't inconsistent with the president's message, right?
I'm not sure, Mr. Castor. Maybe can I ask you to repeat the question?
The president's concerns about the 2016 election and needing to get to the bottom of it, and the president's concerns is it ultimately related to the Burisma company. I mean, if Ambassador Volker is raising that with Zelensky, that's consistent with the direction of the president, correct?
The president's interest, or I would say Mr. Giuliani's interest, because that's what we were, that's what was mm-hmm. very clear mm-hmm. at the time.
Right.
Mr. Giuliani's interest in pursuing these investigations mm-hmm. was of concern, mm-hmm. but.
By the way, do you know how many times Volker met with Giuliani?
I don't.
How many would you guess? Is it, like, was he talking to him all the time or meeting with him all the time?
Mr. Castor, I don't know.
Okay. From his, at his deposition, he told us just once. And, he texted back and forth with with the mayor, and it had a call or two, but it wasn't a pervasive engagement for Ambassador Volker. Were you aware of that?
I was not aware. I was aware of one breakfast, I think, but that's the only one that I was aware of.
And Mr. Kent, before my time expires, I want to circle back to the company of Burisma. And you testified at your deposition that there was an instance where USAID had engaged with Burisma and possibly sponsoring a program, and you took issue with that and recommended the USAID to pull back from that. Could you tell us about that?
So I became aware in the summer, I believe, of 2016 that as a part of what I recall was a clean energy awareness campaign, the part of the USAID mission that worked on economics and governance, including energy, had sponsored some sort of contest for young Ukrainians to come up with a theme, and there was a prize. I believe it may have been a camera. And they had co-sponsored, and with public-private partnership being a buzzword, having a co-sponsorship with Burisma. Given the past history of our interest in recovering stolen assets from Zlochevsky, it was my view that it was inappropriate for the embassy to be co-sponsoring a contest with Burisma. I raised that with the mission director at the embassy. She agreed, and the USAID mission kept the contest but dropped the public-private partnership sponsorship.
The time of the gentleman has expired.